Welcome, LA Progressive friends and family. We're here again with Bill Blum. Bill, you're getting to be quite a regular with the LA Progressive, and we are.
Yeah, it's great. I definitely enjoy it.
Yeah, we're really grateful that you contribute, you know, some of your time. For those of you who haven't seen a Bill Blum interview, Bill is a former judge and death penalty defense attorney. He's the author of three legal thrillers. And he is a contributing writer for the California Lawyer magazine, as well as Truth Dig. And we are going to be talking about a piece that he wrote, and Truth Dig has graciously allowed us to republish it. And we've entitled it Sympathy for the Devil. So, Bill, let's...
So the article starts off with the false equivalency in the media, where the media is pointing to Joe Biden talking about putting a target on something or a bullseye on something, the Project 2025, and comparing that on an equal level with the actual promotion of violence on the right. Do you want to talk about that a bit?
Sure. So everyone knows that there was an attempt on Trump's life at a rally in Pennsylvania on July 13, and everyone was appalled by that. And I mean everybody. And in the aftermath of that, the mainstream media have promoted a narrative which asserts that all sectors of the political spectrum are equally responsible for promoting violent political rhetoric that leads to and encourages crazy people to undertake political violence. And my article asserts that that is nonsense, that the political violence in our rhetoric today comes primarily, not exclusively, but primarily from the radical right, from the MAGA movement, and from Donald Trump in particular. And it's our job to do two things. One, to condemn political violence, because that has no place in a democracy, even in a faltering one such as ours. And two, not to shy away from telling the truth about Donald Trump and his plans for a second term and his use of political violence in his speeches, his use of violence as rhetoric. And if we do that, I think that we can chart a path that's separate from the mainstream media and that is at the same time compelling. We are now entering the heart of the election season, and it's very difficult to focus on Trump as we might have wanted to a few weeks ago. We were focusing on Project 2025, which is this initiative spearheaded by the Heritage Foundation and supported by about 100 conservative groups, which lays out a programmatic blueprint for Trump's second term. Just when that effort was gaining some traction and gaining mainstream media attention, Trump's assassination took place and the focus became one of toning the rhetoric down, turning the temperature down in political debate, and promoting the idea of national unity without really discussing what national unity means. So it's my contention, and I think that this is pretty irrefutable, that Donald Trump hasn't changed one bit. The MAGA movement hasn't changed one bit. And although Trump and sections of the MAGA movement are trying to distance themselves from Project 2025, they really can't, because Project 2025 lays out the ideas for a second Trump term. And it's those ideas are really centered around what we call the unitary executive theory, which basically asserts that all executive power has to be concentrated in the hands of the president, who they think will be Donald Trump, and that the president will have direct, programmatic, day-to-day operational control over agencies like the Department of Justice and the Environmental Protection Agency. And they will dismantle the administrative state and go after the president's political enemies with the Justice Department. And I was just reading this morning a section of Project 2025, which I didn't cover in the article, which says that they want to make Medicare Advantage, which is an HMO program for seniors, be the default option for Medicare and do away with traditional Medicare, which is really the life-saving medical insurance program that people over 65 in this country have, and replace it with an HMO program called Medicare Advantage. So that's another thing that Democrats and progressives need to hammer home, that Project 2025, and by extension, Donald Trump, not only wants to have the largest deportation program in American history, but really wants to dismantle the social welfare state, which has been built up since the New Deal. It isn't very strong to begin with, but they want to tear it down altogether. So the net effect is that while it's important to condemn political violence, it's also important to continue to condemn Donald Trump and the movement that he leads.
You know, one of the things this whole thing is just so exhausting. But what I find a little bit exasperating is the fact that what we're seeing in Project 2025 is nothing but an expression that has been not really covered up. It's been going on for a while. I mean, when you look at the Powell memo that was written back in 1971 and the attempt to take most public spaces and privatize them, that's what you're talking about when you're talking about getting rid of Medicare and going on and shifting it over to the Medicare program that's privatized. This effort has been underway for 40 years with the privatization of prisons, taking public schools and converting them to charter schools. Every area where the public good is the primary focus, they've attempted to, and in many ways, they've successfully attempted to privatize them so that they can extract profit. And whenever there's a disaster, the costs get socialized, but the profit is privatized.
And that's right. And just to follow up on something you just said, the Powell memo comes out in 71 and calls on the private sector to get involved and to transform the legal department of our country in response to gains under the Warren Court. And in particular, to respond to groups like the ACLU. Well, the Heritage Foundation was one of the groups that was formed in response to the Powell memo, or following the Powell memo, in 1973. And the current mandate for leadership, which is Project 2025, is the ninth version of the mandate for leadership that the Heritage Foundation has produced over the years. But it's clearly the most right-wing. The Heritage Foundation has been taken over by extreme radical elements within the American conservative part of the political sector. And Project 2025 is a detailed program for governance under a Trump administration. Now, some of it's inconsistent and not all of it will be implemented, but even if a small part of it is implemented, our lives are going to be transformed. And so I think we need to continue to talk about Project 2025 and use the fact that groups like the America First Legal Foundation, founded by Stephen Miller, who's the proponent of mass deportation, are running away from this group and saying, we no longer want to sponsor this group. When in fact, the vice president of that organization authored the chapter on the Department of Justice. It's crazy. So I think it's a good subject for progressives and liberals to hammer on. What needs to happen now, of course, is that the Democrats have to decide on a presidential candidate, because it does not appear to me and to increasing number of others, and you can tell me what you think, that Joe Biden is up for the job. I don't think he's going to get any better. He seems to be worse with every passing week.
So we'll get to Kamala Harris in a second. But before that, on Project 2025, it's certainly true that Trump and some of his close allies are pretending that they don't support it. But you know that to their base, when they're talking to journalists or the broad public, say, oh, no, we're not that extreme. But to their base, they're going to feed off it, especially, you know, you mentioned Stephen Miller, who to me looks like Heinrich Himmler. they're talking about locking up thousands and thousands of immigrants in camps out in the desert. And is
about 20 million, up to 20 million deportees. Can right. you imagine the militarization of America that would have to undertaken in order to produce that result?
That's right. And I'm sure that they would deploy that to private contractors the way that they have done. I mean, the private detention centers, those people who invest in that have gotten wildly rich since the privatization of detention centers, which led to the private, like the GEO Corporation. Oh, gosh.
Yeah. So Trump and his folks are asking to have it both ways. And we just can't let that happen. I don't know. I do believe the Democrats will pound on that. I see that, hon. Will pound on that. And I think that's a winning argument once the Democrats settle on a new candidate.
So what did you think about Biden?
What do I think about Biden?
That's what Bill asked.
Oh, well, I sort of answered. I said, we'll get to Kamala Harris in a minute.
Well, so
I think Joe Biden, I think the sin is that the Democratic insiders, his staff, high-level Democrats, should have been having this conversation 2 years ago. He was slipping then. They could see what way it was going, and they pretended they could cocoon him and hide him and cover for him, and we're going to pay a price for that.
That's right. We're all going to pay a price, and I think that, like Dick said, this is something that was in the making for a very long time, but I do think that Biden should stop. He should voluntarily give up all of his delegates, because it's just a matter of time, and he's going to have another one of these goof ups, which is going to lead to Trump for sure becoming the next president.
Yeah. So the debate scheduled for September will be another disaster.
Yeah.
And
you don't even need another disaster. The disaster has already happened. It's implanted in people's head that this guy is not up for the job. They don't need to be reminded again, but they will be reminded repeatedly.
What we need to do is to hammer home the message that the presidency does not belong to Joe Biden, that the presidency belongs to the people, and that this is not personal. This is not Joe Biden versus some vicious people who want to engage in some kind of mean girls attack on him. This is our future, and he has got to know that. And the gaslighting that I think is going on among his closest advisors, and we see them all the time if you still can stomach watching cable news, has got to stop. Because it's similar to the gaslighting that you see in the Republican Party.
Yes,
there's a kind of narcissism in Joe Biden that I didn't anticipate. I knew he was slipping. Look, he's 81 years old, and you can't blame him for slipping. But this kind of stubborn rejection of the calls for him to step down parallels in some ways the behavior of Donald Trump without the political violence. So we're in a really bad place, because if he doesn't step down and Trump wins, we're going to be in a world of pain. And I think another message we need to convey to young people is that, it doesn't matter what ethnic group they're in, we all know we have a racist society, but as Jimmy Durante used to say, you ain't seen nothing yet. It's bad now. Get ready for a world of hurt that's coming your way if Donald Trump wins and the Republicans take control of both houses of Congress. It's going to be a nightmare.
So I already hinted that I think Kamala Harris ought to be put at the top of the ticket as quickly and as smoothly as possible. I know some people have said in the past she wasn't a good campaigner. I guess that was true. I see her enthusing the young, the Black, the Indian American, the African American. I think she will put a jolt in a populace that is just like the three of us, is really discouraged by what's been going on here for a number of months.
Well, I think we really just don't have an alternative. I think that Kamala Harris is smart enough. She's had enough time in the position as vice president and in her position as senator. She's made enough connections. She certainly knows how to make a presentation, especially a presentation as a tough prosecutor. I would prefer to see her debate Trump than Biden, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Because I really think that she can put him in his place. But
I think if they put the machinery behind her and give her the resources, I think she has an excellent chance of defeating Trump. She has to be paired up with a VP who meets certain demographic and geographic needs. So people are talking about Josh Shapiro.
Yeah.
Maybe having two women on the ticket. I don't know if that will work with Gretchen Whitmer. Probably not.
No.
Andy Beshear of Kentucky.
Yeah, I've heard people say Jamie Raskin, which...
I think we ought to look around for a veteran who's a labor guy from the Midwest or the East. And unlike J.D. Vance, who actually served in combat and wasn't with the public relations arms of the Marines, I think those are areas where Kamala is deficient with labor and with veterans.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe. There are many choices.
Right.
There's that guy Crow from Colorado who meets those criteria that you just mentioned.
Right.
But if you want to look at the blue wall, maybe Josh Shapiro is a good candidate. I saw some polls saying that he leads Trump in Pennsylvania, whereas both Biden and Harris trail. Mm. So with him on the ticket, you know, Pennsylvania is a key state, and he is pretty popular there. So there are a number of options, but first Joe has to go.
Yeah.
People have to put the pressure on. They really do. The idea that he doesn't have to go because people voted for him, well, people didn't know who how badly in decline he was when they voted for him.
And this is just an indicator. The spot that we find ourselves in right now is an indicator of all the holes in Democratic Party operations and rules. Because,
that's right.
I mean, suppose he had a stroke, or, you know, suppose he was somehow debilitated, not completely, but a little more than he is now. Is there a provision in the rules that deals with that? There's nothing that has come up in the past month that I've heard
of. The 25th Amendment, the cabinet.
That's for the president.
I don't know the answer.
That's not for a candidate. That's for the president.
Yeah. I don't know the answer to that, but I do think there are provisions for when a candidate dies during the campaign.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
state laws would, in the first instance at least, predominate here. So you're going to be dealing with
50 different, you know,
all these different laws.
Yeah. Oh, well, Bill, it's been enough.
But you know where this started? This started, I studied journalism as a kid, and there was a, you know, kind of requirement. If you were talking to one person, well, then you had to go talk to their opponent. And that might have worked when people were normal, but now you talk to somebody normal, and now you have to go talk to a wingnut.
You talking about the fairness doctrine?
Well, just journalism practice.
No. Okay. Well, I think.
Well, this is actually, you know, there is a possibility that he's going to be persuaded to drop out. I mean, that's a good thing. So I think we should pressure for that to happen. And there is a bit of optimism here. I say a bit.
Well, it's never happened before this way. So I think the fact that it's never happened before and that we'd have a Black woman at the top of the ticket, it could energize the base.
I hope it does.
Yeah, I got to say, I'm much more enthused than I was a couple weeks ago when it looked like Joe would hang in. I felt if Joe hangs in, we're done. If we can switch up the deck, I think we have a chance. Not a great chance, but a chance.
I agree.
Well, okay. Well, Bill, it's been great talking to you. Hopefully the next time we'll have a better conversation. You need to bring us some better news, Bill.
I'll try. I'll look around.
Okay. All righty. So long.
Thank you, Bill.
Bye-bye.
Thank you for sticking around. If you like the LA Progressive content and the discussions we have here, please consider clicking the subscribe button below And also, give us a thumbs up. That helps to grow our audience by feeding the algorithm, which helps to get this content in front of more eyes. Thanks for stopping by. We really appreciate your support.